So that was for the background knowledge reminder. Now we will have a look at the XKubeAWS 2.0 package, so the overview. So first, let's start with the multi-account registration. This is a key concept that's really important. So the multi-account registration is only one of the possible options to connect to AWS. You can have just-in-time registration, just-in-time provisioning, one-click X509 certificates. All these methods I won't describe today because they are not supported in our package. In our package, the novelty we bring is the support of the multi-account registration. So it introduces an optional simplified registration step where customers can register their device certificates without requiring a certificate authority to be registered, with AWS IoT. So this is really important. It means that you don't need to have your device certificate signed by a certification authority. You can sign it by yourself and it will be fine. But the drawback is that each device must be individually registered in the AWS backend. So the benefit is that you have no CA to maintain with a private key or get your certificate signed by a CA. But the drawback is that you need to register your devices one by one. Each certificate must be known by the AWS backend. And so the component device manufacturers will be able to offer components pre-provisioned with a digital identity, the certificate, without having to maintain a unique customer-specific CA. So by without having to maintain unique customer-specific CA, we mean that there is no need for a single CA certificate for all devices. So this helps simplifying and accelerating the device registration process. So it fits quite well with our STSAFE A110 SPL02 profile. It's the generic sample personalization profile where we have a device certificate signed by ST certificate. So ST certificate is not a CA, but it's not a problem with multi-account registration. So what do we gain with that? Initially, you had to manage different certificates for a single device to connect to multiple accounts with different CA, because each account had a CA. So each time a device was moving from one account to the other, you had to update its device certificate to sign it with the appropriate CA. Now, you can easily move devices from one account to the other by simply changing the AWS IoT Core endpoint the device connects to. So this simplifies the device registration process and it helps rapidly moving from testing to production. So for instance, you can register, test and configure a device in a pre-production account. And then you can register and use the same device on device certificate. You don't need to change the device certificate in a production account. And so when opting to use this feature, you will also use what we call SNI, Server Name Indication. It will be a string sent by a device and part of the TLS session to route the correct IoT endpoint. So again, what we gain with multi-account registration is an easy way to move a device from one account to the other. You keep the same device identity, the same device certificate. You don't need to have a CA signing your certificate. So I said that it was matching quite well the SPL02 personalization of the STSAFE A110. So let's have a look at this personalization. So in the SPL02 personalization, we create a standard profile. It's quite permissive. It's not the more restrictive one because it's made for evaluation purpose. And what is interesting for us is that it's a complete secure production flow. You will create a key pair for your device, a private key and a public key. And this will be securely injected into the STSAFE. So your customer don't need to care for that. This is done by ST in a secure production flow. And in the case of SPL02 personalization, we The device certificate is signed by ST's self-signed certificate. ST plays the role of a certification authority. So usually this is not great, but thanks to multi-account registration, the new thing in AWS 2.0, we can register this way because this device certificate will be known by the AWS backend. So how does it work? So let's have a look at the concept of AWS connectivity with multi-account registration. The first thing you do is to receive your STCF pre-provisioned. So it's pre-provisioned thanks to the personalization, the SPLO2 personalization. Then on the Amazon Web Services side, thanks to the CLI, the command line interface, or thanks to the web dashboard, it depends on what you prefer, you will create a policy. Create a thing. Now that you have created a thing, if you turn on your STM32, it will communicate with the STSafe, which is embedded on the IoT kit, and it will print the device certificate in a terminal, in a console. You will copy-paste this device certificate in a .pem file, and you will register this certificate on Amazon side. So this is the drawback. You need to do this for each and every device. But the benefit is that you will be able to move from one account to the other. Then you attach a policy, the policy that you created initially to the certificate. You attach the certificate to the thing. You get your endpoint description. So in our solution, but it's not only our solution, that's the way it's working for Amazon FreeRTOS. It's the same for all silicon vendors. You need to update an header file, aws-client-credential.h, and this will give the endpoint to the STM32. You recompile your software, and now you are ready to connect to Amazon Web Services with the multi-account registration feature. So, Xcube AWS 2.0 security. So SBSFU is the secure bootloader. So it will provide a security architecture and it will provide a root of trust to boot the AWS 2.0 IoT application. It will authenticate the application before running it. So this is based on the certificates. It will provide secure services at runtime. This is what we call KMS. It's exposed through a standard interface called PKCS11. And it will rely on STSafe A110 as a secure hardware crypto token for elliptic curve cryptography and as a secure key storage. So we get the benefits from the STSafe A110 secure element. It's used by SBSFU as a root of trust for the AWS 2.0 firmware image authentication. We will extract the certificate from a store inside the STSafe. And it's used by Xcube AWS 2.0 application to connect to AWS server with multi-account registration technology. So in the STSafe, we have a device identity and we have the assets we need for the TLS connection. So the Amazon Embed TLS layer is not fully ported on top of PKCS 11. So it means that server authentication, for instance, will still be performed on NCM32 side. We will come to this in the next diagrams. So secure IoT device, the architecture. So this slide, this is something we have already seen. Well, we have seen almost the same picture at slide number 7. The difference here is the addition of a secure element, the STSafe A110. This brings a better security level as this component is designed to thwart even silicon invasive attacks. With this element, we have a secure safe to store our secrets, the device private key, and ensure the integrity of key elements, the device certificate. So the private key is really a secret. It will be stored in the STSafe A110 and will never go out of it. The device certificate is a public element, something we need to send to the server, so it will be extracted from the STSafe, but the STSafe ensures the integrity of it. So in addition to this, the STSafe A110 also acts as a secure hardware crypto element providing elliptic curve cryptography. So STSafe, the deliverable is a pre-provisioned STSafe A110. So it's pre-provisioned with the device private key and the device certificate. In our package, it's integrated with SBSFU via KMS, so it can be used seamlessly by the application. You do not even notice that you use a secure element. Your application relies on Amazon FreeRTOS. Amazon FreeRTOS uses Embed TLS for its cryptography. Embed TLS is ported on top of PKCS 11. And PKCS 11 is provided by KMS. And KMS then is doing the routing either to STM32 or to STCFR110. We will come back to that in the next slide. So we can highlight that the pre-provisioning in the ST Secure Factory, this is important, is the first valuable asset of our solution. We provide a device that is pre-provisioned securely. The customer doesn't need to care for the private key and its protection. So now let's have a look at the package architecture. So we have our IoT application. So this application can do several things. First, it can print the device certificate. This is a very basic service we need to be able to register to AWS because we need to register this certificate in the AWS backend, as we saw earlier. It can do the TLS uncheck, so to enable the TLS communication. And it can also do over-the-air update. It's relying on Amazon's FreeRTOS. So that's the new thing with this package 2.0. We have Amazon's FreeRTOS instead of the Amazon CSDK. And all this is relying on a secure framework brought by Xcube SBSFU. So we have a secure bootloader. We will ensure the authenticity of this application before running it. We have a secure firmware update, allowing us to implement over-the-air update. And we have the KMS, Key Management Services, to expose our cryptographic services to Amazon's FreeRTOS. So services like Hash, like SHA-256, will stay on the STM32 side, but the elliptic curve cryptography will be offloaded to the STSafe. So it will be ported through the STSafe A110 middleware. We also need cryptography in SBSFU. This is brought by Embed TLS. So that's the thing you need to keep in mind. We have one instance of Embed TLS embedded in the application. This is the first binary. And in our bootloader binary, we also use Embed TLS for cryptography. This allows us to avoid using the ST CryptoLib, and this way we don't need to sign extra document to be allowed to get this crypto library. And at the very bottom, we have STM32 with all its security features like the firewall, the MPU, the WRP and RDP to bring security at the STM32 level. And we have the STSafe A110, which will embed our SBSFU certificates, the device certificate. It will do the job for the elliptic curve cryptography, so generating signature or checking signatures. We also have the possibility of using a TRNG and TLS ephemeral key. In the version 2.0 of the package, this is not used. So handling the TLS assets. So looking back to TLS example, we have an architecture that allows us to use the silicon security features to build a trusted environment to protect access to critical keys and credentials. So on the MCU side, STM32, we have less critical information like the endpoint credential to which server we must connect. We have the server CA certificate. This will be used to authenticate the server. And the critical element, the critical TLS assets are stored in the STSafe A. This is our device certificate. It's not a secret, but its integrity is important. And our secret, the device private key. And in addition to this, all the cryptography operation will be run on STSafe A side. So it means that the key will never be exposed out of the secure element. That's really a valuable asset because it gives a much better security than a solution with only the microcontroller. But on an MCU like the STM32, we have some security anyhow because we can use the firewall. And we can separate secure enclave from the normal code to reduce the risk of malicious application accessing the keys directly. So KMS will run in the secure enclave. It won't be mixed up with the application. So it's some trusted code. It's not as good as STSafe A, but it's a good level of security for a general purpose microcontroller. But of course, the STCF A110 can thwart silicon invasive attacks and it allows to offload the elliptic-curve cryptography. That's the benefits we have. So TLS communication. I put it the other way around compared to the other slide. So this time, the device is on the left-hand side and the server is on the right-hand side. So what will happen? Our device will send the client hello to the server. The server will send the server hello with its certificate. It will send the client certificate request and all the elements we need to do the key exchange. So this server certificate, we need to verify. So STM32 will verify the server certificate. It will verify the certificate chain because this server certificate is signed by a root CA, and this root CA is embedded in the STM32. Then, as the server asks for our client certificate, we will retrieve this client certificate from STCFA. So it's okay because it's a public information, and this certificate we will send to the server. But we need to prove that we own the private key corresponding matching this public key. So what we do is that we ask STCFA to sign a hash proving that the device has a private key, and this certificate verify we will send to the server as well. So as you can see, we have IP communication between STM32 on the server, and we have an I2C secure channel between the STCFA and the STM32. Then we move into encrypted mode and we exchange encrypted messages as we saw earlier.